Great. Well, thanks everyone for joining me for our talk this afternoon as part of Global Leadership Week. I'm really excited to share with you a little bit about our journey at Taking It Global and the work that we're doing really at the intersection of global education and social innovation. And the way that we talk about it is really sparking deep learning, so these new deep learning competencies that Michael Fullan was one of the folks who coined that term. And the way that we do that as an organization in our programs is through supporting real-world problem-solving and engaging students in real-world challenges. Just to give you a little of my own personal background, that's me at the age of 2 with a Commodore 64, sitting there with my dad, pretty excited to get started on that personal computing journey. And that was really the genesis of much of my passion for education and social change, was that experience growing up kind of bathed in bits, as Don Tapscott said, growing up digital with early access to technology and really learning not just to be a consumer, but be a creator in learning basic programming at a pretty young age as well. And that led me down a journey of a number of different ventures, entrepreneurial ventures, and I quickly learned some of my first ideas in school not being successful, this great quote from Thomas Edison, which is, I haven't failed, I found 10,000 ways that don't work. And eventually, after many of those projects that didn't work out, I launched a website with some friends in middle school that ended up being one of the largest websites about computers and technology, called mydesktop.com. It grew to an audience of over 1 million people a month by 1999. We sold it. And, you know, a bunch of high school students selling their company got a lot of attention. We were invited to be on lots of articles, including an opportunity to be on the Oprah Show, which generated a lot of interest that I wasn't really expecting. I had no idea how many people actually watch Oprah and some of those shows. So it got me thinking a bit. You know, I started hearing from students around the world asking for help, mentorship, support. I realized how lucky I was that my parents and my teachers supported my own entrepreneurial ideas, but there were so many young people out there that didn't have that support. And so along with a friend who I was attending a conference with in Ottawa, I thought a lot about what I wanted to do next and what could I do if anything was possible. How could I use my skills with technology to really help create social change and to support other students? And that led us to 16 years ago, actually, to launch this organization that we call Taking It Global. And this vision that we created at the time was really to see how we could support young people in being actively engaged and connected in shaping a more peaceful, inclusive, and sustainable world, and how we could support them using technology to do that. So the first thing that we did is we built a website for students called Taking It Global. And the tagline was inspire, inform, and involve. So we really worked to build a number of different digital programs that helped them along that pathway to action, from being inspired to getting more informed and to getting involved and taking action. And slowly we grew the organization from just the website for students to three key program areas. One, still working with students directly. We call that digital youth engagement through websites and mobile apps, trying to foster civic engagement and involvement. The second is global education, working with schools and educators to bring these ideas and really a technology-supported approach to social innovation into classrooms. And finally, this broad concept of social innovation, which is how can we encourage students to see a future career path and passion for positive social change, almost like social entrepreneurship, often people talk about it as, but ultimately creating positive social impact as a career, as a life choice. And so kind of the culmination of both our programs for young people directly and our work with schools is to try to emphasize and support social innovation culture around the world. So some of the data behind the programs, especially on the education side, that we saw and that really drove our work to try to address the gap. One was around engagement, and there's some older data that the U.S. government collected starting in the 1980s. But if you look back at the My Voice study done 5 years ago, you know, there's a number of data points around engagement in high school. And it's not just in the U.S. We have similar data in Canada. The Canadian Education Association did a study where they looked at every grade, and they found 82% engagement in grade 5, but only 45% of engagement by the time people got to grade 12. So a big drop-off there. And when the high school study of student engagement dug in to find out why, they saw that drop-off was really based on interest, students not finding material interesting and not finding it relevant. Yet, when Gallup looked at the power of this kind of fuzzy idea of engagement, they found a direct correlation between the idea of student engagement and performance in reading and math. Looking at the concept of understanding, and global understanding in particular, The British Council study found that employers thought that an applicant's knowledge and awareness of the wider world was more important than their degree or final grades. And this idea of hope, you know, students feeling hopeful about the future, that was found to be a more robust predictor of success in post-secondary education than their GPA, SAT, ACT scores, and even personality in a similar study done in the UK. So this idea of engaging students and providing them with hope and giving them that global perspective, we found data to support that being really key to students being developing and being successful in the future. And that's one of the things that led us down a journey of not just offering these programs for students, but looking at how we can expand them to support teachers. And I'll share a little bit later about how we've rolled that out at the district and systems level as well here in Toronto, and looking at expanding in other networks of schools around the world as well. Since that launch 16 years ago, and welcome to Lucy, who I saw joined, we've had over 50 million learners, students and teachers, be a part of these communities, join our website thanks to some really generous support we've had of donated advertising from many partners. And they've contributed over 1 million different resources, projects, and ideas. So I'm going to share some of the specific resources we have available for teachers and schools. Most of the content is actually created by the community. And that community is now in grown to 13 languages, so not just in English, but with the rise of second language content demand on the internet, you know, French, Spanish, Arabic, Chinese, Russian, many other languages as well. And so we went from just offering those resources to students to our TIGED platform, which you'll see a link on every page of our site that says for educators. And this is a community that's now numbering over 5,000 schools in 153 countries. I think we just added a new country since I took this screenshot a few weeks ago. And this is really where we connect schools and educators together through a community, resources, projects, and professional learning. And on top of all of that, we have a free learning platform and collaboration platform that lets you design collaborative activities to happen with other schools. And so there's really three focus areas that we've decided to really emphasize across subjects and grade levels. Those are global citizenship, student voice, and environmental stewardship, and really helping schools strengthen those, because we think those are kind of universally applicable no matter what grade or subject you teach, and looking at how we can infuse those into classrooms has really been a focus. And the ingredients that we look at, how can we bring relevance, authenticity, and depth to everything that we do and that we support teachers to do in the classroom. So that's, you know, real-world problem-solving through relevance, the idea of an authentic audience. I'm sure some of you are aware of project-based learning and that being a key way to bring authenticity into the work. And then depth, by connecting it to these real problems, students become passionately engaged beyond just the school day and their homework. And to help schools assess those values, we've also designed and kind of crowdsourced a program called Future Friendly Schools, which provides a set of indicators that help you actually measure at a school level how you're doing on something like student voice and giving you specific ways and helping you understand specific indicators of how you can strengthen student voice or global citizenship at your school. So that's also another program we have for kind of school-wide change and engagement. So just to talk through the resources that I mentioned in my description through those principles, for global citizenship, there's these five different principles of the Future Friendly Schools program. And just to touch a bit on one of them, community engagement, we think there's a great opportunities for schools and educators to collaborate either with nonprofits at the local level or at the global level on some of these social issues. And I'm sure some of you are aware of the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, that were released this year by the United Nations as a follow-up to the Millennium Development Goals. So those went up to 2015, and then last September they launched the next 15 years of goals. We have a great free resource on our website. It's called International Days, and you'll see the URLs at the bottom of every page. And this is where we've got over 50 different days that are great to connect with curriculum so that you can align different activities you might be doing with your students and your classrooms with these days that are happening and being led by different NGOs around the world. So great way to access resources and to connect what students might be doing on water, for example, with World Water Day. And if you're planning ahead for the school year, it's also a great way to see what connections there might be with your curriculum. The idea of global learning, you know, integrating global issues and perspectives across subjects. One of my favorite resources here is our global gallery, which is now, I think we're at almost at 50,000 submissions of student artwork from over 100 different countries. So you can actually learn through art and gain perspectives from students in many different countries. And any classroom can create their own gallery, upload your artwork, and exchange it with others. We also have a really popular educational game section that has over 300,000 visitors a year. You can search by issue or by grade or by subject and grade level, and you can find not only games we've made, because we've created about 10 ourselves, as a charity, but we also have researched, I think, close to 100 games created by other nonprofits and aligned those to curriculum and standards. So a great resource if you're looking for games that might help introduce a certain issue you're looking at or a particular global perspective you want to try to address. And then finally, our core global issues section combines curated primary source content with social media, YouTube videos, Twitter feeds of top organizations, and also student-created content on all these different issues. So we've got these 9 global issue platforms that are curated and managed by our team, and they're great kind of resources for students who might be doing research on different global issues. And a third area of global citizenship I'll touch on is school partnerships. And this is where we really work to support students and schools in fostering meaningful connections between one another. So our program, Global Encounters, which is led in partnership with the Center for Global Education at Edmonton Public Schools, organizes just about one video conference a week, bringing schools together around the world on different issues, from human rights to water to climate change to town hall meetings on global citizenship education, which we've been running this year with UNESCO. One of my favorite ones is one I had a personal opportunity to help lead one year, which is that we've partnered with Polar Bears International, and we've gone out on these tundra buggies in the subarctic with climate scientists and actually had schools around the world connecting live to scientists and researchers. I got to be on one of these buggies 2 years ago, and they get to ask questions and see polar bears outside through the camera we have. So it's a miracle that we have internet on these buggies, and it's a great opportunity to bring the science into the classroom through these global connections. So if you're interested in building those kind of global connections, you can check out the encounters.tigweb.org and see the event schedule we have through the end of this year and what's happening next year. One of the reasons why I think that collaboration is so valuable, the OECD does their TALIS, the Teaching and Learning International Study, every year. And the last cycle, they actually found a direct connection between collaboration between teachers and job satisfaction. So it's not only fun and exciting, but apparently, according to the OECD, it actually increases satisfaction and engagement of teachers. And thanks to Cleary for joining us as well. So and when we look at the principles of student voice, one of our biggest focuses is on student leadership. And this is where we have our free guide to action. We actually have 7 guides to action that are translated into several different languages. And these are guides that support students in creating sustainable social change initiatives that could be part of a classroom project or part of a global, really addressing a global issue. They're completely free. They're Creative Commons, so it means you can hack and reuse them in any way in your classroom. And here in Ontario, we've also partnered with McGraw-Hill to bring these into the civics curriculum. We've actually created a textbook that integrates those action guides. We have our Sprout program, which offers several different e-course cycles each year in guiding students through the process of starting and sustaining a social change initiative. And as of this year, we've now granted over $500,000 in funding to student-led social change initiatives through different program cycles. So that's an important part of us, too, is not just involving them, but actually providing the support they need to actually start and launch their projects. And that's that so far, this program so far has been supported both by Pearson and also by Microsoft. And finally, environmental stewardship. For this one, we're really trying to think about how people can feel like they're having an impact in the small actions they take. And this kind of goes back to my own middle school experience where I went to Vancouver on the west coast of Canada and heard about this Kid Saving the Planet Club and wanted to create it in my own school. And people said, well, we can clean up our yard, but are we really going to clean up the planet? How is our small action actually going to make a difference? And that's one of the things that inspired us to create this app called Commit to Act. And what Commit to Act actually does is it helps you not only track your own actions, but see the actions of others around the world and even compete between classrooms and activities. So it's a free web-based app, works on all platforms, and you can, as a teacher, create a classroom group and track your actions and activities as a group and as a team and see nearly 100 different activities you can take across 6 different categories to reduce your impact on the environment. Another program that the Staples Foundation for Learning in Boston supported a few years ago was the creation of a program called Low Carbon Lunch, and low stands for local, organic, and waste-free. So it's a set of curriculum activities that we have on our website that help you look at the impact of the food we eat, which makes a bigger difference often than the car we drive. Eating vegetarian or vegan meals makes a bigger difference than driving an electric car. And so looking at how we can ensure healthy and sustainable food options are available and encouraging students to have waste-free lunches or meatless Mondays is another part of the environmental side of the curriculum. So that's a little bit about the resources that we offer across the 3 different value areas we focus on. Normally, I could spend an hour talking about them, so there's also a great site map on our site that will give you a tour of the many free resources we offer for students and teachers. And as a charity, all of the web resources and platform is completely free. But one of the ways that we sustain ourselves as a charity is through offering professional learning. And sometimes that's paid for by schools or teachers, and often that's also funded by different grants from foundations or companies. And so we've had really the privilege over the last 5 years now to partner with the Toronto District School Board, and this is Jeff Hainbach, one of the coordinating superintendents who retired last year and really helped us build this partnership. So we've had the opportunity with the TDSB to build this multi-year professional learning partnership to look at how we can bring these values that really connect to social innovation and bring that to life over, you know, North America's fourth largest school system. TDSB now has 558 schools, so it's the fourth largest in North America. And the way we started was working not just at the educator level in one cluster of schools, but also with all the teaching and learning staff. So we've developed 4 graduate level courses, one for each of our focus areas, student voice, global citizenship, and environmental stewardship, and an overall brand new course on social innovation. And we offer that course to 60 teachers from one cluster of schools, and then 60 of the cross-district teaching and learning staff. The second year, we worked with co-facilitators. So some of those lead teachers in the first year became co-facilitators, and we expanded to a second family of schools, another 30 schools, and those co-facilitators helped us co-teach the course and co-deliver it. And then last year, we actually worked with those leads once again to co-design this new course, the Education for Social Innovation course. They worked in clusters at their schools, excuse me, and we worked with some of the top schools to get involved in our Future Friendly School program. So I thought it'd be interesting to also share some of what we learned in this kind of district level rollout. Even though we were looking at online learning, we found that a face-to-face orientation, so we ran a full day face-to-face session, was really key as we looked to build trust and relationships and really grow the learning across the school. We also had leaders as co-facilitators and designers. So, you know, not just having us as the experts, as the external organization, but once we went through that first year of the program, it's been really key to engage. We call them our sprouts, our lead teachers as co-designers of learning, which creates deeper shared ownership and a higher likelihood of success. And we heard, again, from TALIS around that the increased professional satisfaction that teachers have when they get to collaborate. The other thing is often when we first started this course, we ran it as 1 month, you know, one course each week for a month. And what we've learned is we've had much better success when we spread out the course learning over half a school year, often a month between sessions. So that was a big learning point for us that we implemented this last year, and we're looking at spreading even more time between sessions. And finally, bringing learners together to celebrate and showcase outcomes is really powerful. So we actually organized a culminating social innovation student showcase, and I'll paste a video in the chat that you can maybe watch as a follow-up. It's really powerful with students talking about their learning. So not just having the professional learning, but then giving people a month to really process it, share it with one another, develop, you know, the projects in the classroom, and then come back and reflect as a community was a really powerful opportunity. Based on the success of last year, we have also successfully raised funding to grow this program next year, to not just work with the TDSB, but to extend to 5 districts working together as a learning community across the greater Toronto area, which spreads out to 4 other parts, regions within our neighborhood. So the learning goal, which was created by the teachers, was to document the learning process of students with new technologies while they explore curriculum through social innovation projects that reach beyond the classroom. So you can see there's 4 or 5 key points there. Technology for pedagogical documentation is a big theme of our Ministry of Education right now, so that documentation is key. The technology capacity building is key. Obviously, we want this to be curriculum-based. You know, one of the things we learned in the first years is a lot of people saw this kind of work around social change as extracurricular, but we wanted to emphasize that it needs to happen within the curriculum for it to really be sustainable and successful. Every teacher should have a project, so we wanted it to culminate in a project, and the project should have an authentic audience outside the classroom. So a lot packed into that learning goal that was co-developed. And there were 4 sessions after the orientation that this was delivered through. So we had an exploring possibilities session where they learned about social innovations happening around the world, a tool session where we actually had a carousel of technology, so educators presented to one another about the different technologies they were already using We did a survey of what people were comfortable with and what they were willing to share. And so it was really creating peer-to-peer learning within the community. Refining our focus, so talking about how we're going to, you know, what is our project focus going to be and how do we pitch, who do we need to pitch to, and helping the schools prepare, the students prepare and elevate our pitch. And then growing our momentum, you know, what organizations or partners can we engage in our communities in the projects that we create. So it was really about, over these 4 weeks in orientation sessions, culminating in a project they could immediately implement or begin to implement with their students that was not just co-designed between us and the teachers, but was co-designed between them and their students. So we really infuse the student voice and global citizenship work that we do in this learning as well. And it all happened through the same learning platform that we provide for free for teachers to use with their students. We use that. We kind of eat our own dog food, as they say in the tech world, and we use our free learning platform to deliver this professional learning as well. So some of the data we've seen over the last few years is it's been really positive that the district has been independently evaluating our work to date as part of the funding they've received. 93% of educators say they've gained new knowledge and skills that have direct and practical value. There's been a 50% jump in educators who feel that they have the skills to integrate global education in the concept, 73% growth in people who feel able to design student voice projects, and a 66% jump in educators who feel able to enrich students' collaborative and cross-cultural learning partnerships, learning experiences from global partnerships. So that's obviously excellent. We're happy with how the feedback on the from the professional development side. Obviously for us and for anyone doing work in education, we want to also know what the impact is on students. And I'm sorry for I hate using text-heavy slides, but what they've started to do is investigate the standardized assessments that happen at the provincial level and look at the difference between the schools we're working in and other schools that we're not working in. And so with the caveat they have here at the bottom, they have seen an increase, 5 to 6% increase in students in one particular family of schools and a 4% increase in the other in the provincial standards, in those meeting provincial standards in writing and mathematics and reading at certain levels. So we're also at really beginning of looking at how we can assess and understand the outcomes of this on students. Obviously, we see students being hugely engaged, and you'll see that through the video I share in the chat, but we're also hoping to capture some understanding of the outcomes on students as well. So with that, I wanted to leave you with this quote, which we've asked ourselves for many years, that inspired our founding and that our friends at Starbucks put on their cups. You remember these cups they had a few years ago, which is that I think we all wonder, as educators, if our students were actively engaged in all aspects of society and thought of themselves in these different roles as community leaders, problem solvers, role models, mentors, and key stakeholders, how would the world change? And so for us at Taking It Global and this journey on social innovation that we're working on, that's really what we're trying to find out. And I really appreciate you sharing your evening or morning, depending on the time zone you're in with me, and learning a bit more about how we may be able to help you along that same journey. So thanks so much for joining. I know we have a few minutes left, so I would be happy to answer questions either over video. I'll just enable everyone's video and microphone, or on chat. And I'll stop the recording for those of you watching the recording. Thanks for joining us online.